So now we switch to another topic. So before we consider some basic definitions and constructions of, let's say, geometrical approach to the machine learning, now we'll talk a little bit about probability distributions, because this is a really heart of most of the machine learning methods. And the statistical learning theory is based on this probability distribution assumption and the notion. And this is why we have to revive a little bit. Maybe you studied this already, but we have to revive some basic concepts. And from the very beginning, I must give a disclaimer that we won't be able in this course, of course, to repeat all material related to probabilities and probability distributions and probability densities. I mean, it would be a course in itself. But since this is really the heart of the statistical learning theory, we need to revive the most basic things. And of course, we'll just scratch the surface. It's much deeper. If you want to be deeper, please read the books that I have mentioned. Well, it's important for the continuation of the lecture, of the course. What will be important is that if you hear these words, conditional independence, likelihood, probability density, naive Bayes assumption, Bayesian networks, or kernel density estimate, conditional distributions, this word would be familiar to you. At least you could find as a place in the previous lectures where it was simply explained. So the material that I give is hugely oversimplified. And in this place, it's based heavily on the tutorials of Andrew Moore that I mentioned to you before, where the amount of material is larger, more kind of comprehensive. So if you want to understand these topics better, the first thing that you can do is just go to these Moore's tutorials. I give you the links to these tutorials on the webpage. And you can study it in more details. So there's really kind of something that shouldn't give you any troubles in understanding, and should immediately, you should have immediately some kind of mental image, is this combination of words: joint probability distribution. So what is joint probability distribution? So as I have told you, it's the probability of any combination of features to happen. So we have a data set, we have a numerical data table, and just for simplicity, let us imagine that all entries in this data table are discrete. So the first thing that you can do, you can count the number, the all possible combinations of features which happen in this table. So basically, joint probability distribution is a kind of correspondence, dictionary, if you want, in the Python language, between a combination of features and a number which is probability. So it's a number between 0 and 1. So 0 actually means that this combination never happens. If it's 1, it means that in your table you have only this combination of features. So it means that all rows are the same, which is rarely the case. So there is, as I have told you before, in the statistical learning theory, there is this fundamental assumption that your data set, it doesn't exist on its own. So besides this data set and something that underlies it, is a probability, joint probability distribution. So your data set is just a sample, one of the possible samples. It's important to say that it's IID sample, which means independent and identically distributed sample. If you don't know what does it mean, please go to Wikipedia and learn. So your data set is a sample from some underlying joint probability distribution. So imagine that we know this probability distribution. Usually this is something that you derive from the data, but imagine that this is something that is given to you. If you know this probability distribution, that literally it's a very powerful thing. It means that you can predict any dependence together with uncertainties. So you can kind of given combination of some features, you can tell what will be the rest features and what is the uncertainty in this prediction. This is very important to understand. Moreover, if you know joint probability distribution or probability density function, it means that besides the data set that you have, you can generate infinite number of similar data sets which would follow the same joint probability distribution. This data set might contain this same number of points as your data set, but this data set might contain 10 times bigger points or 100 times bigger points or even infinite number of points in so this is really kind of powerful thing, because you can hugely generalize. So I mean, if you ever study Platonic philosophy, it's really kind of Platonic idea that there is some absolute truth staying behind your data set and behind all the data sets which are in some sense is similar to your data set in terms of underlying probability function. Just for your fun, here you have a banana shape probability distribution. In this case, it's a continuous distribution. And you have a probability density function. So this is a function which make a correspondence between any combination of x and y and the probability of observing a point in this position of x and y. So if this number is relatively high, you will observe many points. If this number is close to zero, then you observe very rarely. It's not impossible to observe a point here, but among all possible data sets following this probability distribution, you will find very few with, for example, points in this area where probability density function is close to zero. This is just to have some mental image of probability density function. There will be a word which you will meet frequently in when we will talk about machine learning methods, is the word likelihood. I mean, if you understood these constructions that your data set is a sample from a probability distribution, it's really simple to understand what does it mean, likelihood. It just means if you have a data set and you know probability distribution, then you can compute what is the probability that your data set is a sample from the probability distribution, because some data sets are very unlikely to result from certain probability distribution. For example, in this case, if you'll have a data set with all points located here in this region, the probability that this will be an IID sample from this probability density function is negligible, and so it's almost impossible. It means the likelihood of such a data set with respect to this PDF is close to zero. Usually, when you talk about likelihood, you indeed have in mind these probability density functions, which are given explicitly and usually by formula. Usually in these formulas you have some parameters, like here you have parameter b parameter, so here you have only one parameter. So then, of course, I mean, if you change this parameter, then the likelihood of a data set might change. So in the end, you say that the likelihood, it is the goodness of fit of a statistical model, so to a sample, for a given values of the parameters. So you fix a parameter and you find the probability that the data set is generated from this probability distribution. And this is so maximizing likelihood is the main tool in statistical learning theory. But just a small detail that frequently this likelihood, since it's a probability, frequently deals with very small numbers, so 10 to the power minus 200, which is difficult to deal with the computer. So usually, instead of dealing directly with likelihood, you take a logarithm of the likelihood, just for convenience of a computation. So in this case, you talk about log likelihood. So again, there is nothing complicated in this term. It's just a natural construction which follows from this assumption that your data set is a sample from probability distribution. So how you mathematically describe a joint probability distribution? I already told you that if you have only discrete variables, usually this probability distribution is given by some kind of tabulation or or kind of multidimensional histogram or whatever, but something when you really kind of list all possible combinations, which is exponential number, by the way, if you have many of them, and then you tabulate the probability distribution. Or there are more compressed ways to describe this probability distribution, so we'll be talking about this. For continuous variables, the kind of the method to present probability density distribution, because continuous variables, you cannot list all combination of continuous variables, so the actual tool is a probability density function, and we will have a separate video when I will explain on examples, or remind you on examples, what is a probability density function. And when you have mixed data type, in principle, it's not that problematic to combine two presentations. So we can combine tabulations and probably PDF. So it's not a problem per se. Okay, I guess we need just to be on the same ground, and you can skip this material if you're very familiar with this. But to be on the same ground, let us remind what is the probability and some basic notion of probability theory. Probability theory is very simple in the case of discrete variables. So this is why we should start always with considering discrete variables. Just imagine, also we define an event. In case of discrete variable, we define an event A. Is a Boolean valued random variable. A is a Boolean valued random variable if A denotes an event and there is some degree of uncertainty if A happens or not happens, if it occurs or not. Example of Boolean valued random variables. For example, US president in 2023 will be male. So we don't know what will be in 2023. We don't know if the president will be male, but maybe we can talk about probabilities of this. I'm not sure, by the way, that we can talk, but or probability that you wake up tomorrow with a headache. Or, I mean, just to connect to the current reality, you have a COVID infection also. You can estimate this probability. But this probability is highly conditional on what you do, actually. This is something that we will talk about, conditional probability. So what does it mean, probability? Again, intuitively, like probability is quite philosophical notion. And so you can, Andre Moore gives this definition that it's a fraction of possible worlds in which A is true. It's really kind of definition which is connected to the hypothesis of existence of multiple worlds, of possible worlds, and again, at this point we can stop and start to discuss what does it mean probability, and what does it mean in terms of philosophy, and do we have possible worlds, or we have one single fixed world, the world. Philosophically, it's quite complex question, but let's don't do it. Some definition like this will be sufficient for us, at least for solving technical problems. So we'll talk about worlds, possible worlds, and set of possible worlds. So in terms of visualization, you can use this a simple trick to visualize probabilities and conditional probabilities, and this is something that we'll do here. So for example, the space of all possible worlds, we will denote as such a square, and let's say that the area of the square is 1. Then we can split this world, all possible worlds, into set of worlds where A is false and the set of worlds where A is true. And we will represent the set of worlds where A is true by this oval. And then we can compare them. If we compute the area of this oval, so this will correspond, according to our definition, this will correspond to the probability of event A. Probability, I mean, not any numbers can serve as, can be probabilities. So there are axioms of probabilities. There are four of them, and three of them are quite kind of trivial. So one is we say that probability is a number between 0 and 1. It can be 0, it can be 1, so it's included. Let's agree that the probability of truth, of something which happens all the time, will be 1. It's a matter of notations. Probability of something which never happens, false, is 0. So this is simple. And then we have this already formula, which is presented as an axiom. So this is not something that you are supposed to derive. So probability of A or B. So if you have two events, and you have a kind of complex event, which consists in the fact that either A happens or B happens, is the sum of the probabilities minus probability of the event, of another event, which consists in the fact that both A and A, B happens at the same time. If you will so you can interpret these axioms, you can visualize these axioms using this trick with the areas of squares. So for example, this is a probability of very highly unlikely event, so the area is very small. But this area might grow, but it cannot grow bigger. So the probability of event A cannot become bigger than the whole all possible worlds. So it's it cannot be bigger than one. Then about this condition. So what does it mean? So actually, it's again, it's easier to understand it using these trick with areas. So this is a probability of A is this square, and this probability of B is this square. And of course, nobody said that these two areas shouldn't intersect. I mean, they might intersect, and then you have this area, so it's surrounded by black line here, which is exactly the area, which exactly corresponds to the probability of the event, which consists of A and B, so that A and B here happens simultaneously. So the area of PAOB, it's this one, the green one, because any point in this area corresponds to either A or B. And then this axiom is simply calculation from of this area of PAOB, because you just sum up areas of A and B, but this part you count twice when you sum up the intersection. So you have to subtract it one time just to correctly calculate the area of A and B, AOB. Okay, so this is simple to understand. And I mean, if you forget this formula, you should always remind you, kind of recall this mental image. This is extremely simple, and as a, I mean, but these axioms are very important. I mean, why is they important? As a matter of fact, I mean, probability theory is not the only theory about uncertainty in events, uncertainty of our world. There were many other attempts to introduce kind of to describe uncertainty. Some of them are mentioned here. But this axiomatic approach to probabilities has the following property. Actually, sometimes probability theory can be used, and it's known that it can be used for gambling. And imagine that you play a kind of probabilistic game, a card game, with your opponent, and your opponent has a theory about uncertainty, which is based on, for example, fuzzy logic. It was proven that if your kind of strategy of playing is based on the these axioms of probability, then if you play long enough, then you will gain this game. So you will be the winner. So it's and it was proven 100 years ago, which, by the way, all these notions of probability theory were established. That the axioms of probability, they are quite distinguished in this respect. So they most closely correspond to the properties of our world, if you want, of real world, because this gambling is something real which you can try in real life. But again, I mean, when we talk about axioms, as a matter of fact, these axioms are just elementary applications of basic set theory. So you have intersection of sets, you have a subtraction of sets, union of sets. So there is nothing really about even probabilities in this respect. The actual probability theory starts from the notion of conditional probability and conditional independence. So we will talk about conditional probability here in this video, and we will talk about conditional independence in the next video. And conditional independence is already a power, and the notion of conditional independence already a powerful tool for machine learning, for making predictions. So this is conditional independence is really the heart of statistical learning theory. But to go there, we have to recall once again. I hope that you know these things. What is conditional probability? So conditional probability is denoted as such, and it's read as a probability of A given B. Given B means that we take probability of A when we know in the situation when we know that probability of B is true. So in other words, it's a fraction of worlds in which B is true. So we fix it to true. And also A is true. So we can visualize it again using this area visualization tool. Imagine two events. Now let's come to kind of be close to reality. Unfortunately, this is reality which is quite common. Today, instead of flu, you can consider the virus we're all talking about today is imagine that F is a probability that a person has a flu, and H is a probability that a person has a headache. Let's assign already some probability. So probability of headache is 1 to 10. It's probably that one day in 10, you have all day, you have headache. And 1 to 40, it means that once in every 40 days, you are getting flu. Just to give some concrete numbers. Then again, you can visualize the probability of F, probability of H. You have some intersection. And so what is the conditional probability in this case? So let's compute the probability of F given H, meaning it's a fraction of all cases of flu, which is accompanied by headache. So headaches are rare, flu is rare, but if you're coming down with flu, there is a 50-50 chance that you have a headache. Okay, so this, I hope it's quite clear. So half of the flus are accompanied by headaches, but not all headaches are caused by are connected to the flu. So this is what we see here. So then let's compute this number. So how to compute this 150? So really you have to take this area, which is a probability of headache and the flu, and divided by the total area of F, which is the probability of F. So therefore, you have a formula for the conditional probability that the probability of headache caused by flu or connected to the flu is a probability of having simultaneously headache and the flu divided, and this is very important not to forget, divided by the probability of having flu. As a matter of fact, it's a definition of conditional probability. And once again, it's connected just to simple consideration of areas. But this is really the first notion in the probability theory. Now, so we define conditional probability as such. And then the main value actually of this is that now you can compute one very important thing, is the probability of the two events A and B happen simultaneously. And this is something that we want to compute in most of the applications actually. What is the probability that two events happen simultaneously? Then there is this chain rule that you just take a probability of A given B and you multiply by the probability of B. Or equivalently, you can take probability of B given A, and but in this case, you will have to multiply it by the probability of A. And this is a from this, you immediately come to this formula, which is called Bayes' rule. This is the most fundamental formula in the statistical learning theory. Bayesian rule. So basically, here we have the definition of conditional probability that we just illustrated with areas. And then we apply chain rule to expand this probability of A and B. So we expand it like this. And then, so this formula connecting that conditional probability of B given A and conditional probability of A given B. So this is the most fundamental this is the foundation of the so-called Bayesian approach. So now, just to give you another illustration, what is joint distribution? We already talked about this, but this corresponds exactly to what I told before, that if you have only discrete variables, only binary variables, then you can make this a truth table, where you list all possible combination of events A, B, and C, so all possible combinations of 0 and 1 that you observe, that you can observe, and then you assign some probabilities of these events. And then, so you can visualize these probabilities using areas, and then so, for example, this area corresponds to the event where A, B, and C happen simultaneously. So this corresponds to the row 1, 1, 1. This is the probability of this event. Once again, from this picture and from this table, equivalently, you can find all possible conditional probabilities. So the joint, if you know the joint distribution, even in form of such a table, it's how you compute these probabilities actually. So imagine that you have a truth table for three events. One event is a person is a female or male, the gender. Then is it poor or rich? It's wealth and the number of hours worked, I guess, per week. I don't know what does it correspond to in the UK system. I guess in the French system it should correspond to the number of 35 hours or something like this. But in this case it's 40 hours. And we construct a truth table, so we have all combinations of these features, and we assign some. Imagine that we have some statistics, and we estimated these probabilities from some big data. So we summarize them into only these frequencies, which are called, by the way, these are frequencies of these combinations. So then, using this table, we can compute any combination of events, the probability of any combination of events. For example, to compute the probability of that a male is a poor male, is just you have to run through all rows in this truth table and sum up all probabilities where you find the both poor and male, disregarding what you have in this hours worked. So in this case, there are two rows, and they sum up to this number. Okay. let's say more generally, now you how to compute conditional probabilities. So again, we use this definition of conditional probability, and so I mean we already know how to find the probability of a complex event, which is n of two events. It's just you have to sum up all rows matching E1 and E2 simultaneously, but you have to define to the probability of E2. It means that you have to find the probability of all rows when you have rows matching E2. So very simple. For example, let's find the probability of a male given that the person is poor. It's not the same as a probability of a poor male, because not all males are poor. According to this theory. So then simply you first you again you count this green line, these poor and males, so this probability of poor male, but then you find all rows where you have poor as an event, and you have four rows like this, and then so these four rows include these two rows, of course, of poor males. But here are the cases of poor females. And then you divide one sum by another sum, and then you have a conditional probability of a male given poorness is higher than the probability of a poor male. So just simple illustration, but this is something that you should understand very clearly for understanding Bayesian networks, for example, or all Bayesian approaches. So just to conclude, joint distribution. This is a central notion of statistical learning theory, which is a foundation of many of big part of machine learning. So good news, if you know joint distribution, if you can estimate it, you can ask important questions, and you can actually predict many things, to guess probability of many combination of events together with uncertainties. The bad news is that, I mean, I already told you that if you have many variables, then tabulating, let's say, joint distribution becomes problematic. Because how many combination of 10 Boolean variables we already have? 1,000. The question then, how much data you need to estimate the probabilities of these 1,000 combinations. Let's say if you want to know the probability with certain precision, for example, up to the first digit, then at least you need to have 10 times bigger number of points. It's a very rough estimation, order of magnitude bigger. It means that already you need 10,000 data points to estimate probabilities of combination of 10 variables. It's envisageable in principle. It's already can be considered big data, but it's not a super big data, let's say. But if you have 20 attributes, then the number of combinations that you have is already 10 to the power of 20. How much it is? It's 1 million combination, approximately. If you want to estimate the probabilities up to the first digit, which is very rough estimation, you need already 10 million data points. And if you have 30 variables, then forget about this tabulation. You will never have a data set big enough, you will never have such big data to estimate probabilities of all possible combinations of 30 attributes. So this is something that important to understand, and here I end talking about conditional probabilities.